was, and is to come. Amen. We have no idea what's in the future, but we have some knowledge of what was in the past. So says Lebanese-American Nassim Nicholas Taleb, author of a book entitled The Black Swan, The Impact of the Highly Improbable. This morning, I'm rather imagining a hypothetical conversation that Taleb and Jesus might have had if they were contemporaries with one another. Judging from this morning's gospel, this first Sunday in Advent, as we hear Jesus speaking to his disciples with some very disturbing imagery about that future moment when the Son of Man suddenly will return, I have a suspicion that Jesus and Taleb would have a lot to talk about. Yes, we are still basking in the warmth of our tryptophan bliss after a wonderful Thanksgiving holiday, and here we have a scriptural wake-up call that makes quite the splash. But if news of Jesus' second coming hits us this morning like a cup of cold water to the face, I want to assure you, God is no Grinch scheming to spoil our party. If you're here this morning, you probably are not necessarily the ones for whom this epistle to the church in Rome was originally intended. You are up, you are in the light of day, not playing about reveling and drunk, not quarreling or jealous. You have looked at what it means to be connected, to be covered with the armor of light, putting on that imagery of Christ's light. We carry it inside of ourselves. In baptism, we see it represented with a candle. And this morning, we've got this light alluded to, illuminated in our wreath. And what I think about when I notice all these images of light is that it's one of those parts of our lives that comes and goes and flickers, and we pay attention to it in fits and starts. In my prior career, I served for nearly 2 decades as a financial advisor, and I witnessed human behavior responding to all sorts of surprises. Earnings reports for publicly traded companies, Federal Reserve announcements about hikes and interest rates, life changes of all sorts, from layoffs to new births to weddings and celebrations. All of it was part of this glorious array of challenges, surprises, and excitement that investors buckled up for. They knew to expect, in part because of that classic admonition. You know the one, past performance does not guarantee future results. Well, most of us that were in the markets didn't really like the disturbing tendencies to which that classic phrase alludes. Yes, life often defies our expectations. There was a certain class of investors, though, option traders. They were the ones who lit up like a Christmas tree at the prospect of volatility. Maybe you are some of them out here in this room. For traders like these, the greater the standard deviation, the greater the potential upside. Taleb was one such Wall Street trader, and he had uncanny timing. He published his book, The Black Swan, at a very remarkable moment, and it became this theoretical lens to sharpen our observations about the unanticipated, unprecedented, and far-reaching effects of the global economic crisis that began in 2007, that same year his book came to the market. That so-called Great Recession, stood out for many reasons. It was the first such significant downturn since the Great Depression. And it was marked by quite a few things: predatory lending practices, excessive risk-taking by financial institutions, and yes, something I know touched us even here in California, the bursting of the U.S. housing bubble. These woes occupied our attention for no short duration, even as Taleb's authorial acclaim took the world by storm. When you catch the eyes of the folks like Robert Schiller, you know you've made a splash. But the term that Taleb popularized, the black swan event, was not a novel idea. It actually came from a period in the 17th century, when scientific minds in the Western world assumed all swans were white. No one had yet encountered a swan of another color. But then, in 1697, Dutch explorer Willem de Vlaeminck encountered black swans in Australia. This turned zoological studies upside down, a discovery that illuminated how random events don't actually seem quite so random in retrospect. Well, if you paid attention to the way the world has unfolded since that time, you probably can guess Taleb's work has been applied to help global markets bounce back and become more robust, buffered by regulation and risk management techniques that were designed to strengthen our systems to withstand future shocks. But we all know black swan events happened long before 2007, and they continue to happen even today. So what does this have to do with us? As we come here, the beginning of the new church year, looking with hopeful expectation toward this idea that Christ coming could possibly be good news for our lives. Well, I think it's because in spiritual community, we grapple with the wholeness of our lives together, the good stuff and the hard. We remember and integrate our histories, however murky, by looking back on what has been, even when pain and difficulty are present there. Because the past teaches us how to cultivate hope as we anchor our lives in God's love instead of fear about the future. Unknowing, after all, is a hallmark of our creaturely condition. God's own nature continues to be unfathomable to our human understanding. And Jesus admits, right here in today's gospel, that there are things God hasn't even yet revealed to the Son of God. Now that's something weird to ponder. The time when all things will be brought to their fulfillment is a mystery, even to Jesus. So when we look at our lives and we notice how God breaks in and those surprises change us, we can actually calm down a bit and not worry so much about having to be prepared. Because being awake means we're present, alive to the moment where God always resides. Yes, clarity sometimes emerges in hindsight when we look back on what has been, but we never know how to perfectly translate it forward. There will always be black swans we don't know about. Take that great flood of Noah's day, a story very familiar to Jesus' hearers, and whether or not we know that tale as well as they did, its plotline might seem pretty predictable. Back then, no one anticipated a flood wiping out virtually all life on the planet. That simply hadn't happened yet in human history. Those rescued on that ark Noah built with God's strange blueprint made it safely through the deluge. Love provided a haven of protection. Amid uncertainty and unknowing of how that moment would turn out, love's presence was there. Those people, all the animals, took the leap of faith together into community. Community in close quarters at that. And there, in the middle of it all, they discovered connections that held space for saving grace. Being with my family over the holidays for the first time in 5 years this past week, I found myself really mulling this gospel. The alienation that we've been living with, especially since COVID broke into our lives, isn't so different, after all, from what the people of Noah's day had encountered. Around the Thanksgiving table this year, there were dear ones missing. My sister's father-in-law died at the end of 2021. And yet, even with his absence, enjoying all the flavors and textures of that meal. I nodded off in the back seat on the drive home. How often do you actually get to do that? My brother and I stayed up late in the night catching up, and it was so healing because we had had a hard time of it during the pandemic. I chased my nephew around the house playing dinosaurs. Yes, you might have guessed I was Triceratops. It was kind of hilarious, though, watching him at the age of 4 and these things that he does over and over and over again as he is learning about the world, like wanting to rewatch and rewatch this part of Charlie Brown's Thanksgiving special, you know, when Lucy pulls the football out and then yanks it back at the last minute and Lucy's sprinting down to it, swearing that he's going to kick it this time to the moon. Every repetition of that scene sent my nephew into fresh peals of hysterical laughter, and I was, you know, shrugging beside myself, watching his parents rewind the story again and again so that he could keep on enjoying watching him with this desire to come back again and again to that moment in the story, making sense of why the world sometimes does that, just pulls the rug right out from under you. I found myself thinking about Jesus' words about the days of Noah and those epic events that no one suspected. It's actually a story I've thought about quite a few times during these COVID years. And ironically enough, watching my nephew and what he was doing, I started imagining the story of Noah proceeding in reverse. Instead of those two people in the field and one suddenly getting whisked away, I imagined in my mind's eye women and men gently sliding back into their respective places, reconnected to community without fear, shame, or confusion. Somehow the calm of that image helped me realize, even in the midst of all we cannot know in this moment, God is here. Advent gave me access, in a strange way, to a different kind of black swan event. Because healing the alienation of our world and redeeming these dear losses feels like a pretty impossible thing right about now. If we're to believe Jesus, that God is neither safe nor predictable as we might prefer, then we have to